a triumphant moment for Admiral Bardock. Aboard his Victory-class Star Destroyer, the Obedience, he could see that all of his ships had arrived. The two Gazanti carriers were preparing to launch their bombers. The Thai advanced fighters had arrived. The Star Destroyer Desolation, on loan from Admiral Izar's fleet for this attack, was at his flank. And at the far end was their reason for coming, the Interdictor, the Orio. The Orio had the ability to take ships out of hyperspace, or to keep them from going into hyperspace to begin with. Its use today would be to keep the Rebel fleet from escaping. The Imperials had set a trap for the Rebels, the same trap they had used twice already. They had placed a tracking device on a droid that one of the operatives seemed very attached to for some reason. When the Rebels rescued that operative, they rescued the droid as well, and they were taken back to the fleet inside Thull's Shroud. That had led the Empire right to them. They were just a little further in, and they were helpless. Only two corvettes and a frigate. Not a match for the mighty Empire. This would wipe away the humiliation Bardock had felt at the hands of Rebel operatives on Deminol when they had smashed a transport into the base he was guarding. He had only been promoted because of a need for local officers, so he intended to earn that promotion here and now. Bardock ordered his Star Destroyers full speed ahead, and they launched all of their fighters and bombers. He wanted to pounce on the Rebels before they knew what hit them. Out of the red broom appeared a clump of shadows, the Rebels. There were three capital ships, some oblong shapes that looked like transports, and a cluster of small vessels that were obviously fighters. Bardock would have been excited, except that they weren't in front of the Star Destroyers, and they weren't sitting still. They were moving, and they were headed full speed straight for the Interdictor. They were not being ambushed, they were doing the ambushing. The frigate Centurion and the corvette named Shadow Raptor rushed right into the Arroyo's face. Their X-Wings hurried to the Imperial squadrons, locking them in place to protect the flanks of the larger ships. "Hard to port!" Bardock shouted, his voice cracking with worry. He knew it was too late. Orders in a Star Destroyer had to go down the chain of command, and the lumbering beasts were slow to turn. As their noses creaked inchmeal to the left, two more apparitions appeared out of the fog, this time slightly off their starboard bow. They were long, thin ships, identified as missile frigates. Their markings revealed that they belonged to House Draco. They had at last chosen their side. Bardock would inform his superiors that House Draco was to be crushed once he was finished here and could send long-range communications outside of the nebula. The Draco ships pushed forward, their flanks in front of their Star Destroyers, letting the Imperials come to them. The other Rebel ships dove in hard and fast to the Arroyo. They knew that it could keep them from launching into hyperspace, but they did not intend to leave. Not with that ship still intact. It was the only one the Imperials had in the sector, and they didn't intend to let it get away. They all opened fire on the Interdictor's port shield, whittling it away. The squadron of combined Rebel fighters, this was the group used in Games of X-Wing led by Jake Fabry, finished off the port shield. And as the ships passed by, they blasted it with everything they had, leaving it burning as they went. One of the Draco missile frigates moved ahead of the other, creating a perfect crossing of the T's in front of the Star Destroyers. Their drone ship, meanwhile, engaged Imperial squadrons again, holding them where they were. The Arroyo, accelerating away from the Rebel ships, found itself face to face with one of these missile frigates, who threw its missiles into it, blowing up the Interdictor. In a blinding rage, Admiral Bardock ordered all guns of both Star Destroyers to open fire on the Draco ship in front of him. It was ripped apart by the enormous firepower. He then pulled the Obedience further around to port, slowly making its turn so it could open its batteries on the Rebel fleet. The Desolation followed suit. The Rebels, however, had different plans. Far more maneuverable, the corvette swung around behind the Star Destroyers, and they opened up on the Decimator's rear shields, breaking through them. With the help of the mixed squadron and the frigate at long range, the corvettes continued to throw fire into its rear. Draco's remaining missile frigate continued to hit the Desolation from the front, and, sandwiched between the enemy ships, the Desolation was smashed to pieces. That left the Obedience all on its own in the middle of this nebula surrounded by Rebel ships. It was now a question of whether or not he could escape. The Rebels clearly did not intend to let that happen. They fired away on his rear shield and broke through, smashing the point defense system and causing a fire. The fighters continued to go at one another, the Rebels whittling away the Imperial squadrons. Now the Imperials struck back at them, taking out the Draco ship and one of the squadrons of X-Wings. But the Rebels were relentless. They stayed on the rear of the Obedience, concentrating all of their firepower. Bardock shouted at his pilots, demanding they get them out of there. It was his final order. The Shadow Raptor fired into an already exposed part of the ship, hitting the power core and causing the Star Destroyer to explode. All that was left was the Gazanti carriers. The captain of the Strako ship knew that if it got away, the crew would tell the Empire that they had joined the war, and they wanted that secret kept just a little bit longer. So they threw all their missiles into the carriers before they could jump to hyperspace. That left only Imperial fighters. The X-Wings finished off the last of the TIE advance squadrons, then broke off from the others, disappearing into the mists of the nebula. The remaining TIEs could not go past light speed, so they would remain stuck within the nebula forever, unable to call for backup, unable to call for rescue. The Rebels did not engage them. They just turned away and disappeared from view. Admiral Izar was setting up to finish the Rebels and their allies in one swift stroke. He had three fleets in the sector, accompanied by three armies and scattered garrisons of ground forces and TIEs. One of those fleets and armies was supporting an attack onto Resti Kel, the capital of House Kellerman, who had been supporting the Rebels. House Casito had been uncertain about this move as Princess Lyra and the revolutionaries had taken some of their worlds and were moving on the others. Izar assured General Barazan that as soon as the Kellerman capital was taken, they would turn around and retake any worlds that were lost. He was going to further warn them that if they left Kellerman around, they would find themselves continuing to fight on two fronts. But there was no need to tell him that. The animosity toward House Kellerman was so strong that Barazan was merely needing a small shove in that direction. What Barazan did not need to know was that when they would turn to liberate the Casito worlds, it would not be to give them back to Casito. This was the opportunity the Empire had been waiting for to take over the Juvex Sector, one house at a time. As for the Rebels, they needed to know where they were. This was handled very simply. When the Rebel base had been crushed on Zeluria, one of their raiders captured a pilot and his droid. Twice the Rebels had fallen for the trick of placing a tracking device inside of a droid. Third time's a charm. So Izar ordered his subordinates to place a tracking device onto the astromech droid. Then he had given them as a gift to House Casito on Asiathora, where he believed the Rebels were most likely to strike next. He was right. The pilot and his droid were taken first to the revolutionaries' base on Diol, then to the Rebel fleet in Thul's Shroud. The signal from the tracking device took a while to make it out of the nebula, and it was a faint signal, but they could tell where it was. So Izar bolstered Admiral Bardock's fleet with an extra Star Destroyer and the Interdictor and sent him to finish off the Rebels inside the nebula. He could not go as his own fleet was guarding a special project for the Emperor, but what Bardock had should suffice. Admiral Forduff, meanwhile, would support the attack on Resti Kel. Most of that would be done with House Casito and House Srethan light cruisers, but her Star Destroyer Tirpitz, her raider the Guderian, and her carriers and fighters would ensure no one escaped. The attack on Resti Kel was just beginning. The one on Thul's Shroud was supposed to have already ended, and Izar was a little confused as to where they were. But he figured Bardock was finishing off any survivors so there would be no seed to grow again. He also got a report of two other attacks. The first came as a strange surprise. House Strako was attacking cruisers from House Srethan that were trying to fly through their territory. This was unexpected, but what came next was an even bigger shock. House Casito's capital planet was under attack. Izar assumed the assault would be repulsed the moment they saw that Casito had placed two of its cruisers in its orbit along with some Imperial carriers and other vessels Izar had sent them from his own personal fleet as a show of goodwill to Casito. The report came back to him directly from Casito. They were being attacked by a fleet of capital vessels. It was the Rebel fleet. The one Izar had thought was in Thal's shroud. "Then where is Bardock?" Izar began to ask. But then he realized. He knew the answer. The Rebels are supporting their allies in their attacks for freedom. Click the link for the battle you want to watch. After the battle is done, you can watch one of the other battles, or go on to the next video. Thank you all for watching, and may the Force be with you.